the Sunday school class. When you get a train going, it's hard to stop the train, so we apologize, but we are glad that God is here. We want to let you know Mike Baldrock is at home and he's doing good, so we thank God for that. And we're so glad that our Miss Marge is here. Marge, it ain't the same church without you. We're glad you're here. And I'm so encouraged by you people that can spend a week or two in the hospital and the first chance you get to come to church. And I'm encouraged by that, and I hope that you find strength here. And so, Marge, we're glad you're here. I don't know of anything that we have going on this week except today at 5. We have a gifted and talented class. It's going to be a very interesting class, I believe. If you've never came, you're invited to come. Huh? And then at 6 o'clock, we're back in here in 1 Corinthians. And then Wednesday is Awana's and Bible study. And so we encourage you to come. If you have neighbors or loved ones that have young children, we encourage you to invite them. We believe in the Awana program because it's word-based. And if any time in history that your children need to have the Word of God put in them, it's now. And so you might ask yourself, what's so important on Wednesday that I can't come to hear with God's Word? Now listen, it's more important, it's vitally more important that you are a student of God's Word than your children. It drives me nuts when people say, yeah, I need to get my child in church. Your child needs you to be in church and studying God's Word. So we're so thankful for those that volunteer to help us in those areas. We want to start today by saying our pledges. So if you'll stand with me, we are going to say the pledge to the flag of the United States of America. And so we're going to put our hand over our heart and repeat after me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Now we want to pledge our allegiance to the Christian flag, and that's by extending your right hand toward the flag. Would you say it after me?
I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again with life and liberty for all who believe.
Now, Zane, would you help us? All right, Zane, we appreciate you. We want to pledge our allegiance to God's holy word.
I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and I will hide his words in my heart that I might not sin against God.
Thank you so much. And remain standing as they come to lead us in praise and worship. We want to dedicate this service to God, and we want you to help us. You pray. Don't listen to me pray. You dedicate yourself to this time that you allow God to speak to you. And that's what we're here for today. So let's pray and dedicate this service. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We don't want to go another step without dedicating our hearts and our lives once again to you. We set aside this time this morning, and we ask you to come. Send your Holy Spirit in this place. Your Holy Spirit is the answer, is the doctor, is the counselor, is the provider, is the lover of our souls. God, you know the hearts of all the men and women and boys and girls in this place. Your Holy Spirit can reach them and teach them and touch them at every need. We just ask that you come. We set aside ourselves and we beg you to come and have your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. This torment time, and the Lord heard me.
thank you so much for coming. If you're a young person, you want to go to Children's Church, these ladies will take you back there. You know what? One day I think we ought to do, we ought to set up a camera back there and just live stream the Children's Church service on the TV for the rest of it. Wouldn't that be cool?
Yeah,
heck yeah. I think that'd be awesome. We might learn something. Got one straggler there. She found her way. All right. Well, thank you so much for coming today. We want to preach a message. I don't think I've ever heard this message preached, but that's usually my fourth day anyway. But we're going to ask you a question today, each and every one of you. And we would like you to try to answer it. And I'm going to show you here in the Bible. It's in several different places. What doth hinder you? What is hindering you from becoming everything that God has for you to be? You understand that God has a plan for your life, but virtually no one ever lives up to the plan. But the God of the universe has anticipated your life. What would the God of the universe want you to be? How would he love and desire for you to live and act? And even though he's the God that created the universe, you still have your free will to become or to reject what his plan is for you. So the question today is, what is hindering you from becoming what God dreamed you would be? If we can decide a few things that are hindering us, then we can remove them from our lives. Listen, there's nothing more important than you being faithful, that your life being what God designed and intended for your life to be. So today, what is hindering you? So we're going to go to Acts chapter 8, and we're going to look at a few things here. And it won't be so much preaching as it would be teaching, but there are some things here that I think you need to understand. Look at Acts chapter 8. Now, this is a very strange section of Scripture. You have a person, the Apostle Philip, who is being translated, much like Spock and Captain Kirk were beam me up, Scotty. He's just translated. So let's see. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise and go toward the south unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. So you're in a desert, okay? 27. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, an eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem for to worship. Okay, now hold it. Most preachers, teachers, they don't teach this. This eunuch is from Ethiopia. He is probably, most certainly, a Hamite. He is probably a black man. He is, according to the word of God, a eunuch who's in the service of the queen. But he has, you got to understand, most people teach this, that he's a heathen, he's from Ethiopia. There were Jews in Ethiopia. There are still Jews in Ethiopia. This man is going to Jerusalem to worship. He has a scroll of the book of Isaiah. He is, I believe, a Jew. If he's not born a Jew, he's converted to Judaism. He's going to Jerusalem to worship. He's from Ethiopia. He's the head treasurer of the Ethiopia country. But he don't have a clue about Jesus Christ. He's never heard about Jesus Christ. He's never heard about the crucifixion. He's never heard any of it. He's never heard about Acts chapter 2 when the Holy Spirit was sent and the day of Pentecost. He don't know nothing. Is this at a time of a pilgrimage feast? Probably so. He's going to Jerusalem. He's in a chariot. Is he by himself? Probably not. Watch the story unfold before you. So he's going to Jerusalem to worship. This is the first occurrence of the gospel of grace to be preached to anybody. It's in Acts chapter 8. And notice it was first preached, according to God's word, to a black man from Ethiopia, a servant of servants. Watch this. He was returning and sitting in his chariot, read Isaiah. That's just an English way of translating the Hebrew word Isaiah. It's Isaiah, the prophet. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join thyself to this chariot. And Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah. So he must be reading this scroll. Here's an Ethiopian eunuch who can read Hebrew out loud. Must be reading it out loud. Because he heard him read the prophet Isaiah and said, Philip asked the eunuch, understand thou what thou readest? So he's asking this man, you understand what you're reading? What is he reading? He's reading a section in Isaiah that talks about the crucifixion and the coming Messiah, that God would come. So Philip asked him if he understands what he's reading. And he said, how can I, except some man should guide me? Do you understand there are people that you come in contact with? There are people in your life that God is counting on you to guide them to Jesus Christ. And if you don't, you would be an agent of hindrance. Watch it. He said, how can I, except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him in his chariot. Must have been a pretty big limousine chariot. The place of the scripture which he read was this. He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearers, so opened not his mouth. I told you the part he's reading was about the crucifixion of Jesus. But he don't understand that. So, verse 33. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. And who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this? Who is he talking about? Of himself or some other man? He don't have a clue. Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? So what was hindering him? Now, you won't hear this anywhere else. This is not New Testament, early Christianity baptism. This is a Jewish baptism. This eunuch don't know nothing about the crucifixion. He don't know nothing about the resurrection. And he most certainly don't know anything about the new church, New Testament Christianity baptism. He's a Jew. But he's just believed through the preaching of God's word to him that through the prophet Isaiah that Jesus had came. And that he was God. And that he died on a cross. You go back and read it. As they went, Philip's preaching this whole gospel, right? And God came and he was born. He may have took him in the scroll to the place in Isaiah where it says that the son was born, that son is the Father, God, the Almighty. He may have took him there, we don't know, but he preached him the gospel from God's word, the book of Isaiah, and the eunuch believed on Jesus Christ. Well, any life-changing event to a Jew, you had to be baptized to seal it. There were four different reasons they were baptized, and I've taught it to you ad nauseum. If you don't know the four different reasons Jews were baptized, come to me after the service. I'd be glad to talk to you about it. But they were baptized hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times throughout their life. Well, this eunuch just believed on Jesus Christ. He does not know that the early church had a baptism in the name of Jesus. But I want you to notice something. Do you think this eunuch, most likely has a group of people with him. He's not going to travel by himself. He's a very important person. He's the head of the Federal Reserve of Ethiopia. He's the head money guy. Do you think they're in the desert and they don't have any water? If sprinkling is baptism, why didn't they just take some of their drinking water and flick it in his face? But no, baptism is a type or a picture of a death and burial. You can't picture the burial by sprinkling or spitting or flicking water in someone's face. He's in a desert. He's got some water. He needs a body of water to get submerged in. Why? Because baptism is a type of the true baptism. When the Holy Spirit baptizes the believer into Christ, submerges you into Christ, you become part of Christ. You become bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh. You are part of Jesus Christ. This baptism will not save you. And neither will sprinkling. The Jewish baptism was a submerging. That's what the early church took as a baptism. But to think that he is wanting to get baptized like most of y'all were baptized, you're cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. And as they went on their way, they came into a certain water. And the eunuch said, "See, here's water. What doth hinder me to be baptized?" Now notice, I want you to think about this all the way through the sermon. I promise I'm not going to keep you long. I got something to say, but I'll do it fast. He didn't say what's stopping me. He said what's hindering me. And if you'll go to Webster and look up the word hinder, it means to impede. In your life, your problem's not that somebody's stopping you. I mean, you're here. You're not chained up in a basement at home. You're not in prison. Nobody's stopping you. That's not the question today. The question is, what's hindering you? What's impeding you? And that's what this man asked. He said, "What is hindering me to be baptized?" Verse 37. That you will not find in most all new Bibles. It's the most important verse of the whole chapter. And Philip said, "If thou believest." Now, that sets the stage for baptism, doesn't it? Baptism comes after you're born again. Baptism comes after you believe. Baptism is not a part of your salvation. It's an act of following God's instructions after you've been born of God. It's not a requirement. They're not even talking about New Testament church baptism. Watch it. And Philip said, "If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest." And he answered and said, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God." Well, he must have had a pretty good sermon before. How could I know unless somebody told me to where he finds a body of water and says, "Hey, I'm ready to be baptized." And he commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch. And he baptized him. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, beating him up, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. So the eunuch left rejoicing, verse 40. But Philip was found at Azotus, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea.
Yeah, I guess he did preach. I guess he had a word. I guess he had encouragement. Why? Because he had shared his faith with another person, and through the word of God, God had birthed this eunuch into the kingdom of God. If you've never allowed God to help you to be a person that helps lead another person to Christ, you can't save them. I had some people tell a bunch of people the other day, this is the man that saved mom. I didn't save her mom. But if you've never allowed God to use you to help lead someone through God's word to a saving knowledge of Christ, that they would be born of God, you've been a hindrance. So, here an Ethiopian Jew coming to Jerusalem to worship, reading the scroll of Isaiah, Philip preaches the gospel of grace to him for the first time preached, and he believes. He knows he needs to be baptized because he's a Jew. He's not talking about early Christianity baptism, church Christianity baptism, New Testament Christianity baptism, but he is baptized after he was born of God in compliance with the command of Jesus. He asks, what doth hinder me? So the question is, what? And the question goes out to you today, what hindering you? What is hindering you? Is it family and friends? Do you say, well, I don't want to sell out completely to God. I mean, what would my family say? Are you talking about what they would say now or what they would say when they're in hell? See, your family might say now, hey, you don't need to be such a fanatic. I mean, come on, 5 o'clock Sunday. And then that fat boy-headed preacher wants you to stay from 6 to 7. And Wednesday night, of course, Wednesday night's out of the question, man. That's what your family might say now. What do you think your lost family's going to say when they're in hell? They're going to say something like this. Why didn't you invite me to Sunday night at 5 o'clock? Why didn't you put me in the gifting down the class so I could find out the deep things about God? Sunday school? You mean you went to Sunday school and they gave away free donuts and you never... Free donuts? What are you talking about? What would my family and friends say? You mean what they would say to you now or when they're in hell? Ooh. I want to give you a little clue. The Bible says that one day God will wipe all the tears away. But that's way after the white throne judgment. And the Bible says you and I, children of God, will sit in the jury seat. And you will sit there. You will not get up. You will not. Sometimes when the Holy Ghost gets a little heavy in here, you got people start popping up because all of a sudden now they can't hold their liquid. You will not get up. You will not walk around. You will not have to go to the bathroom. You will not hide your face. You'll sit there and you'll watch it. And you'll watch billions or trillions of people and angels come before the throne of God. And most of them, you won't know them. But you'll sit and you'll watch those people that you've met. And the Holy Spirit quickened you to tell them about Christ, and you refused, and you were a hindrance to them. You'll sit and you'll watch your loved ones that you supposedly love, but you didn't love them enough to tell them about Jesus Christ, and you'll sit and you'll watch them get condemned and go to hell. You'll sit, you'll watch your family, you'll sit there and you'll watch your friends. And the reason why he wipes away all the tears is because it won't be nothing but one big tear fest. And it'll be too late. And you'll be on the jury side, and you'll be assured of everlasting life, and you'll watch those people you said you love be sentenced to everlasting death. And the only thing that'll make heaven heaven is God promises that after you've lost your ever-loving mind, thinking about how you were a hindrance to those you said you loved, He will wipe their remembrance from your mind. Heaven would not be heaven if you could remember your loved ones that you never shared Christ with. Heaven wouldn't be heaven if you could remember all the people that you were embarrassed to share Christ with, and you knew they were in hell. Heaven wouldn't be heaven if you could not erase from your mind their face as they're being cast into the lake of fire. Some of them your children. Some of them your mamas, your daddies, your uncles, your aunts, your cousins. So God wipes away their remembrance. They're never remembered again. Why? Because maybe you was the hindrance. So, he asked, what doth hinder me? I'm asking you, what's hindering you from being everything that God wants you to be? You are as close to God right now as you desire to be. What's keeping you? You know, yesterday I went to a car show. I love looking at those old cars. I got to share my faith several times. I got ready to leave and I said, oh, wait, I had a shirt on. I said, I need to wear my shirt that says pastor, because it says Matoaka and it says pastor, and that might start a conversation with people. So the whole day I'm wearing it, and it started multiple conversations. It caused some of the people to make fun of me, you know, and I'm good with that. I can take that. You know, they're like, well, this guy claims to be a pastor. You know, I'll take that. That's cool. I'm a man. I can dish it out as well as David. But it gave me an opportunity to share my faith with a lot of people. And I was just walking around in some beautiful cars, man. And you know what? The Holy Spirit said to me, the problem's not cars. The problem is worship. See, the Bible says that God will give you the desires of your heart. It's not a bad thing for you to have something that you enjoy. The problem is worship. If you like old cars, it's God's delight to give you one. The problem is it going to be a hindrance? If you like to fish, there's nothing wrong with fish. Jesus Christ was a fisherman. Most all the disciples were fishermen. The problem's not fishing by no stretch of the imagination. The problem's not a $2,000 fish finder. That just helps you find more fish, right? The problem's not having a nice boat. God don't want you to get out in the middle of the lake and your old piece of junk won't start and run. How's that a witness for Christ? The problem's worship. What's hindering you? Maybe the question isn't what is hindering you. Maybe the question is, who are we hindering? Let me show you. Do you inspire or quench the fire in people? Do you inspire people to want to live for Christ, or do you quench the fire? Look at Mark chapter 10. These disciples, they thought they was doing good, but Jesus God. This is one of the only places you can find where the Bible says Jesus God. Really, really mad. Watch it. Mark chapter 10, verse 13. Watch this. And they brought young children to him that he should touch them. These families, these mamas and these daddies, all they wanted to do was to have Jesus Christ put his hands on their babies as a blessing. Now, if you go to verse 2 of chapter 10 of Mark, the Pharisees came to Jesus. And there wasn't no blowhard disciple trying to stop them. They let them come right to Jesus. His time wasn't too precious for the Pharisee devil worshipers. Disciples didn't stand between him and them, watch it. And they brought young children to him that he should touch them. And his disciples rebuked those that brought them. Rebuked those that brought the children. But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased. And said unto them, suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. Notice, not the kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein. You've got to come to Christ as a little child, humbly. Pharisees don't make it. People with the heart of a child do. Watch it. And he took them up in his arms, put his hands upon them, and blessed them. So the disciples mean well. They thought Jesus didn't need to be bothered with these little brats. And Jesus takes that opportunity to show the disciples he's much displeased. He said, unless you come like these children, you can't come to the kingdom of God. Don't hinder these people, these children, these souls from getting to Jesus. So it wasn't what was hindering, it was who was hindering them. People can become an agent of hindrance. So, are you in some way a hindrance to others that are trying to get to Jesus? Is your lack of worship a hindrance to those that don't know how to worship? Would babies in Christ or lost people look at you and say, well, there must not be much to it. They don't worship. Do your friends and family see you at a football game and you're just epileptic and you come to church and you look like a corpse? Is it your lack of worship, outward worship, hindering those that are looking to you? Is it your hateful attitude? Are you known to be just a little spitfire? Are you allowing your children to be disrespectful and hateful? That's a hindrance. Is it your hateful attitude that's hindering other people from seeing Jesus in your life? Is it your lack of commitment? Do they see your lackadaisical commitment in your life and it hinders them from believing that there's anything to it? Is it your unwillingness to witness? Is it your embarrassment to the gospel that's hindering others? Does God have a plan for you to share your faith with others like Philip, but you don't, so it hinders those people from hearing God's word? Maybe your lack of biblical understanding is a hindrance to you to witness. It's not what's hindering you now, it's who's hindering you. Are you a hindrance? Do you inspire folks or put out their fire? Thirdly, what does hinder this church? I found a church in the book of Galatia, in the town of Galatia, the book of Galatians, and they were being hindered by somebody. In Galatians, it wasn't what that hindered them, but who
The question today is the who you? Look at Galatians chapter 3, verse 1. Oh, foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you or hindered you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you? He says, oh, you foolish Galatians, who bewitched you? Who set you back? Who put a spell on you? Who put a witch's spell on you that you couldn't see the truth anymore? That you would believe a lie? That it would hinder your progress as a church? Well, the Apostle Paul had started the church at Galatia, and he had a love for the church, and he asked them this question, who is it? Is the who you? Who is it that is hindering the Matoaka Baptist Church from being what God would plan for it to be? You know, people think, well, God's plan, if it happens, it's God's plan. That's not true. So, this is important. It's vitally important. The Church of Jesus Christ in the world today is vitally important. It's the most important thing on the planet. Yet, from the commitment of most of those that claim to be born of God, you wouldn't notice it. That's a hindrance for people that are lost, that are like the eunuch. Maybe they're looking and they're studying and they're searching, but they don't have anybody to lead them. It's a hindrance. The salvation of men and women, boys and girls, is really all that matters. Look at verse 8 of that chapter 3 of Galatians. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham. See this ideal that God would save or put his spirit in the heathen, in the sinner, in the one that you think there's no way. They're probably closer to God than anyone else. It was preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So this ideal that God would be preached, that God would use people like you, like me, but primarily like you, that you might be the conduit that God uses, like he used Philip with the eunuch, that you might have a working knowledge of God's word, that you could take a person, a loved one, a friend, a stranger, and show them in God's word, like Philip did the eunuch, how to be born of God. First of all, their need for it. Then the path and the plan. Are there people in your life that are searching for God, but they can't find him because you are their hindrance? The other day, I got a call from a lady. She's visibly upset. Nobody in her family goes to church. They don't give a flip about God or the things of God. But her mother is dying. Now all of a sudden, everything in her life is changed. She's quit going to her job because her mother's dying. You understand what I'm saying? So she called me. She said, they are putting my mother on hospice tomorrow. Well, hey, she knows what that means. I know what that means. You know what that means. She said, they told us, hospice told us, once she goes on hospice, she may not be awake or coherent enough to talk. Is there any way you could come and talk to my mama today? I said, I'll be right there. Now, I want you to see how this plays out.
Now all of a sudden, the only thing that matters is her mama is going to spend eternity in hell. And the whole world stops. And she calls me. Now listen, I am a talented individual. I have fixed multiple leaky faucets. She didn't ask me to come fix her mama's leaky faucet. I have unplugged hundreds of stopped up toilets. I've even stopped some of them. She didn't mention anything about her mama's door. I used to roof houses. I don't know if her mom's roof has a leak or not. She didn't mention fixing her mom's roof. I'm a pretty good shade tree mechanic, but she didn't ask me to look at her mom's car. With tears running down her face, she said, "Would you come and talk to my mama and make sure she don't go to hell?" And listen, I'm a human being. I got red blood in my vein. I wanted to say, "Why you call me?" Do you know how humbling that was, probably, for her to pick up that phone and call me? But I was kind. I didn't say, "Why don't you talk to your mama?" The woman told me I wouldn't know what to say. I don't know how to make sure she goes to heaven. I want to ask something. Who was a very big hindrance in that woman's knowing how to talk to her mama? Her very mama. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? The mama had not taught her daughter anything about God. Her daughter didn't know how to pray with her mother. Her daughter didn't know where to take her in the scripture. Why? Well, her mother had been a great hindrance to her. We don't want you to be a hindrance to anyone. Wouldn't it be amazing if this church was filled to the brim with people who were not people that quenched the fire of God in people, but inspired people? They understood their Bible. They had a working knowledge of the Word of God. They were consumed with God's Spirit and His power. And they were just looking like prey. They were just looking like hunters or fishermen for the souls of men and women. And when God put them divinely, He took Philip and beamed him up. Why? Because the eunuch was looking. Would you even consider that God could divinely direct your path that you might find people who are looking for Christ? Amen. And when you get there, what would it be like if every one of you had the working knowledge of the Word of God and the witness on the tip of your tongue that you could lead this person to a saving knowledge of Christ and that person? This woman calls me. What's the hindrance in her life? One of them was her own mother. So when I got there, I talked to the elderly woman, and she said, "I've been in and out of church my whole life, but I don't know if I'm saved." She said, "There's been times I've thought I have been, then there's been times I'm sure I lost it, I wasn't, then I think I got it back." Confusion. That is not God's plan for people. So I talked with her. I shared with her God's Word. I didn't mow her lawn. I didn't change her doorknob. That all didn't matter all of a sudden. Her daughter wanted to make sure that she didn't spend eternity in hell. So, the daughter didn't even know how to lead her own mother to Christ. Somebody had hindered her. Who's hindering you? Why wasn't the mother concerned for her lost children? I left that house and I was praying and I was thinking And I thought, you know, I talked to that lady for over an hour. She never was concerned about her daughter or her grandchildren. She got multiple grandchildren. Listen, this woman knows tomorrow is the countdown. Put yourself in that shoe. If you know tomorrow, 8 o'clock, they're coming to give you the morphine popsicle. Would you not be concerned for those people that you're leaving behind? Would you not be concerned for your grandchildren, your children, that you would want to make sure that they were born of God? She never mentioned it. Why? She never even thought about it. Somebody had hindered her. Somebody had hindered her from knowing God in the way that God had meant for her. So I ask you today, what doth hinder you from being what God would have you to be? Whatever that is, you need to get it out of your life. Now listen, we're not talking about stopping you. We're not talking about something that has stopped you. You would see that for what it was, and you would probably deal with that. We're talking about something that's just impeding your progress. We're talking about something that's just hindering you from being all that God would have you to be. No matter what that is, you need to get it out of your life. So would you stand with me as Diana comes? I want to give you just a minute to think. We're not going to embarrass you. We don't even care what it is. But we'd ask you, I can't make you. I'm going to ask you to just take a moment. And I want you to bow your head, close your eyes, and just ask the Holy Spirit, is there anything in my life that's hindering me from getting to you? And then if he gives you something, deal with it. I'm going to give you a minute. Then I'm going to pray and dismiss you. And we're going to have people up here at this altar to pray with you if you need prayer. If God lays something on your heart and you want us to pray with you, you don't have to come up here and tell us what it is. Just say, would you pray with me? We'd love to pray with you. If you're lost and you do not know Jesus Christ, we'd like to introduce you to him. So I want to give us just a minute of silence. I want you to ask. I want you to say the words in your spirit. Close your eyes and ask God to show you, is there anything in my life hindering me? And then I'll pray and dismiss it. Take a moment of silence when you talk to God. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And we thank you for your Spirit that you put within us and that communicates with us, speaks to us. God, we pray today that your Spirit would speak to us loud and clear. God, I pray if there's anything in me or in my life hindering me from being what you dreamed of me being, I ask you to help me to get it out of my life. God, help me to see the urgency of the day. I pray for these people in this room that they all search and have the Holy Spirit to search their hearts today. We want to be pleasing to you. I pray that you raise up an army of soul winners out of this church. In Jesus' name, amen. Folks, you are dismissed. If you need prayer for anything,